Well, I meet some old mates. I've just met Dermot Crowley, whom I first met in about 1974, and Paul Blake, and I was at the National Theatre about 100 years ago with Sylvester McCoy. So, you know, you meet old mates, you were once young, and I enjoy these things. I quite enjoy them now. You know, really, I don't do them that often. I think that's probably why I enjoy them. And you sell a few pictures. Yeah, that's it. Still sort of, in a very tenuous way, part of the industry. Well, initially they wanted somebody who was tall and thin, and so they got me. I'd been in the West End, a show in the West End, and I had no idea what Bibby was going to look like. There were no drawings, no sketches. They wouldn't show me them at all for some reason. They wouldn't. It was all very secretive. It was a bit like joining the Secret Service. And gradually, I did 3 months pre-production. I was doing a TV series at the same time, but I was going up to Elstree on days off and having casts made of my hand, my face, etc., my eyes done. And it was really only the Friday before we started filming that they put the whole lot on. And when Nick Dudman put the makeup on, he wouldn't let me look in the mirror. He turned the chair around, so I had no idea what I looked like, none at all. And then they led me to a full-length mirror, and I had everything on. I had the makeup, the costume. I saw what Bibb looked like for the first time. And so I had a kind of idea of how maybe to play him. It was a bit like doing a mask exercise in a way. And that was it. That was it. It just was a case of turning up and, you know, taking the job seriously, although you felt like you were a bit of a big kid in a funny costume, this weird set with all these different creatures, most of whom you never knew who was inside them. We had a huge, I had a huge dressing room because of the makeup. And people used to come in because we had a coffee machine. I had no idea who they were. They were all wearing masks and they were kind of sipping coffee through straws and mumbling away in the corner. And I have no idea who they were and they had no idea who I was. So anyway, that was it. After 5 weeks, away we went. I never thought about it because I was a professional actor. I didn't know much about Star Wars at that time. I'd missed the original film because I was working in the theatre. So in those days, if you missed the film in the cinema, you missed the film. It wasn't going to be in TV. There was no DVD, no video even. And so I didn't really know much about the phenomenon. I'd seen Empire Strikes Back because I'd worked with Tony, and I'd gone to see it because of him, really. I enjoyed that, but I had no idea about this whole Star Wars phenomenon, you know? Then bingo, it all happened, you know? There are some CGI actors who are very, very skilled, and they what I relied on very heavily was standing in a mirror and looking at Bibb. You know, I really just kind of absorbed something from this image. It seemed to be quite almost feminine, you know, quite almost hysterical. And I took it all from there, and that seemed to work. Now, if you're working in CGI, there's nothing to look at. There's nothing, you know, you've just got to use your imagination to some degree. So I don't really know totally what the answer to your question is. For me, if you're an actor, it must be much easier if you're on a physical set. You can look around. You can see stuff. You can see all these creatures. You can see what you're doing. You can react. You can get into that. Whereas I think green screen acting is a completely different skill. And I'm not so sure it's something I would, having done it the old way, I probably would find it quite difficult. Although, you know, look at Andy Serkis. He's built a whole career on developing the skills around being that kind of an actor. You know, he does it very well. You walk on a film set. I remember the day I walked on to do the lighting test on the Friday, first day they made me up, walked on to the set of Star Wars and saw, the first thing I saw was a full-scale X-Wing fighter, you know, which is almost as wide as this room. And you just go, wow. You know, that's what a film set is like. You walk into a film set and a studio, and the studio is built as something. It does take your breath away. There's something quite powerful about it, you know? Whereas if you're just walking in a big green screen, it's just a big green screen in a way, you know? It was like I did a film called The Keep, and there was one studio which was all the interior courtyard of a castle, the whole thing, and it was massive with huge walls and stuff like that. So it was really quite awe-inspiring. We just walked on the set. It kind of did something for you in a way, you know? It got you going. Yeah, it kind of, you thought, I kind of realised what I'm slotting into here, I know what I'm slotting into. You know, you couldn't walk onto, whoops, you couldn't walk onto Jabba's set in Return of the Jedi and not kind of get an idea of what you were meant to do. You know? You look around, you think, oh, in the name of God, what's this about? You know, I'm part of this. So you just get into it. It just helps you as an actor. It just nudges you into to something. But that's, you know, to do it where you're just moving between green screens and still produce something convincing, I think, is quite extraordinary. Maybe it was easier for us. I think it was easier, despite, you know, the physical pain was worth it.
One of the more iconic images from the Star Wars universe is, of course, our first glimpse of Carrie Fisher reclining in her now iconic and often imitated Slave Leia costume.
Yep.
Did you realize at the time how much of an iconic image that was going to become?
No.
No?
I don't think any of us did. I was a bit taken aback. I thought, that's Princess Leia? I mean, she was lying like that for about 4 weeks, because it took us 5 weeks to film all that. She was just lying around, bored, you know, just with this bikini on, which was incredibly uncomfortable. No, but I mean, I just thought, I suppose I, if I thought about it, I thought, yeah, it probably would. Probably would turn into an iconic image just because it was Carrie wearing next to nothing, you know. And she was, I had to lift her up in one scene and get her to kiss Jabba on the barge scene.
Yeah.
And you kind of, you know, you're going to lift somebody, you look at them and you sort of mentally gauge their weight. And she's quite slim and small and petite in those days, so I knew she wasn't going to be heavy. But I was very tired after about 4.5 weeks of being dressed up as Bib. And I couldn't grip anything because my fingers were rubber and they'd bend back. You know, I couldn't eat anything. I had to be fed. I was like an invalid. People shoving straws in my mouth and tea on the end of it. Anyway, I kind of measured Carrie. I thought, yeah, okay, yeah. I've got to lift her right the way up. That's going to be a bit of a push, all this garbage on. But she was about, you know, 50% lighter than I thought. And I lifted her up and I nearly threw her through the ceiling. Lift her up to her. There's nothing to her. She's just, you know, like a feather.
And on the flip side of that, what was it like being slapped by the Jabba puppet?
That, I was very proud of that because the stuntman was very concerned and they were thinking about dressing a stuntman as me. And, you know, it wouldn't have fitted. The costume, the makeup wouldn't have fitted. And it was only a drop of about 2 feet onto the floor. And I said, no, I'll do it, you know, I'll do it for God's sake. I couldn't see anything through those lenses, just a hole drilled in the middle. And Peter Diamond said, no, this is dangerous, mate, this is really dangerous. I said, well, no, I'll be all right, all right. He said, okay, I'll stand off and I'll catch you if anything happens. And I said, okay, so Jabba hit me. They couldn't see a damn thing either. They were just lashing out at something, which is me, and I just fell off. And, you know, you just thought I'd dived off the Eiffel Tower. Peter Diamond, everybody said, God, that was brilliant. It looked absolutely dead right. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. Didn't one take. I mean, all I did was literally fell about 18 inches onto my feet. So it wasn't the greatest stunt in the world, but they were terribly impressed.